So another artist's impression of that I guess just about any of us could do, trying to recreate and envision what was going on. This is the result. So here's a lovely map showing Vesuvius up here. So there's Vesuvius within Sommer. Here's Pompeii. The distance between Vesuvius and Pompeii is about 9 kilometers. And everything within the red zone was completely destroyed. And coming out in this direction, the wind was obviously prevailing from the north, and material accumulated out in this direction, up to 10 centimeters thick out here, but 2 meters thick proximal to Pompeii. We tend to hear only about Pompeii and Herculaneum being destroyed. Herculaneum's here, just out to the west of Vesuvius, whereas Pompeii's out to the south. But there are other towns on the coast down here in the Bay of Naples, and right on along this coast, all towns in this region were pretty much wiped out. I've actually got a sample that I found in our collections of Vesuvius, a little column, and this is what rained down on them. This happens to be the product of the eruption in 1906, April the 7th to the 15th. But you can see it's been sorted by Italian scientists, no doubt, in terms of grain size. So here's coarse material. And as you go up, it gets finer. And I've deliberately cut the slide short, but the very fine ash, this is labeled ash and lapilli. So the correct scientific term for material of this sort of size is lapilli. And of course, one of the profound impressions we have of this eruption is the death of so many people. More than 1,000 bodies have been found in excavations of Pompeii. There is still more to be found. It's estimated that there are 400 to 500 other bodies, undoubtedly. And you can see, I hope, the nature of the material around here. It really is just blobs of pumice. You could be on the beach at Taupo, frankly. Having said that, it wasn't quite like the pumice that we have in Taupo. It was darker, it was more scoriaceous. The actual rock that came out is andesite, so it's more like Ruapehu or in that sense. And what has been determined is that the bodies all relate. We scientists are endlessly, you know, classifying things. We can recognize a number of layers that are very distinctive with respect to this eruption. And layer E, from A to H, layer E is where we found all the bodies. And this relates to the final 5 to 6 hours of the eruption, when the eruption column collapsed and we had these extraordinary pyroclastic flows and surges. So as I say, people would have been able to survive, they would have been able to move around and get out up to a considerable time during the time of the eruption. However, come those last 5 to 6 hours and nobody would have survived. I'm not going to read this out. These are really notes for me. The key thing is that the eruption was less than 30 hours long. The second phase of the eruption, let me explain the collapse of that column and what the column is. And I'm going to give you, straight up, a soap bubble. That's what this is. I think it's great. What it shows is somebody's finger making contact with a soap bubble, right? You can see a little bit of the intact bubble here, but look at all this fragmental material. It's not unlike a glass of champagne. The bubbles come up and then they explode. Why do they explode? Why do champagne bubbles explode? Because they emanate from inside a liquid, and there's gas in there, but it's under some pressure as a function of the fluid, of the liquid. Gets to the surface, breaks through, and now you've got a little bubble, and the pressure inside is greater than the pressure on the outside, and so it must perforce explode. And I want you, this is a take-home message, everyone. I really want you to understand that this is essentially what volcanic ash is. Volcanic ash is merely a zillion, 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 zillion exploded bubbles. Bubbles of what, you may say? Well, we're starting with liquid rock, and that liquid is at some temperature between about 850 degrees centigrade and 1200 degrees, that sort of range. It depends on the composition, chemical composition, and in particular the silicon content as to what temperature it will be, as well as how much water content and gas content, CO2, etc., there is. So, but somewhere in that range. So we've got liquid rock, and it's gas charged, and it's going from high pressure to low pressure. It suddenly finds its way, as it were. So the first 22 hours of the eruption were clearing the throat and evacuating the magma chamber, which is 7 to 12 kilometers below the surface, and then it reaches a kind of point where suddenly the pressure is such, it's depressurized to such a degree that it now wants to boil like mad, and the whole magma chamber starts doing that. And it just roars to the surface and blows out cleanly, in this case for 5 to 6 hours pretty much. And what's coming out is liquid rock, and it gets into an environment which inevitably is at lower pressure and colder. And so you will end up with a great deal of material turning into glass, balls of glass, effectively. And then those glass balls explode, and you end up with this extraordinary thing that we call volcanic ash. So it really is pretty much along the lines that I've just suggested. But in amongst all that, there is crystalline material that happens to have formed within the magma chamber, crystals growing out of the melt, if you like, and they get entrained. And there's also, as the eruption gets going, the force is so great that it's actually ripping the side of the throat of the volcano to shreds. So vast amounts of country rock or the rock surrounding the volcano's throat gets thrown out as well. This happens to be from the Mount Ruapehu eruption of 1995-96. I'm not sure which, but I guess there'll be people here who do know. And more importantly, perhaps more spectacularly, Mount St. Helens that erupted 18th of May 1980. So this is exactly the same sort of phenomenon. And this magnificent audiovisual that we've got up in the Pompeii exhibition was put together by our colleagues in Australia, in Melbourne, and what they based that on is indeed imagery, existing imagery of this sort of volcanism, largely from Mount St. Helens, but also Mount Unzen in Japan in 1991. Is it Japan? Yep. And then, of course, it was Mount Unzen, by the way, where the craft, husband and wife, and 41 other volcanologists and journalists lost their lives because they were so close. But the result is some, dare I say it, some spectacular footage of a pyroclastic fall deposit coming roaring down the volcano's flanks. So the imagery that you've got here, that we've got on display in Pompeii, is, I put it to you, remarkably faithful. It's a very good rendition of what must have happened. This is I now want to think about the history of Vesuvius briefly. This is a geological map. I won't dwell on it, but the bright reds, pinks, yellows, they all relate to volcanism that has happened since the Pompeii eruption in AD 79. So this has been a very active volcano. The present shape and form of Mount Vesuvius largely relates to things that have happened in 1631 and since then.